Years ago, I lived on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. And my live-in girlfriend at the time decided to clean house one weekend. She came from the Midwest and she had a lot of old clothes she decided she didn't want anymore. And she determined to just throw them out. So we took all these clothes in boxes and carried them outside. It was a cold night in mid-December. There was a homeless young man sitting out there. He was white, in his 20s, very thin. He had a blanket wrapped around him, and his face looked gray. When he saw all these clothes, he asked if he could have some of them. And we said, well, they're women's clothes. But this didn't seem to bother him. They began to go through Barbara's dresses and her coats, trying them on right there in the alley, coughing, with the cold wind blowing. And I went back inside and brought out some soup for him. His hands were shaking, and the soup spilled as he ate it. He had a foreign accent and said he was from Hungary. He claimed he'd been some sort of electrical engineer, but now he couldn't get work, couldn't get a visa. His wife had left him, couldn't pay rent, and he was living on the street. I remember that he was particularly angry about the fact that he was fair-skinned and that white people rarely gave him money. He talked about how the blacks did better as beggars because white people were more likely to think that blacks needed help than whites did. He said he wished he was black, because if he were black, he'd be better able to survive. He took off his pants in order to slip on a pair of Barbara's tights underneath them. Then he put one of Barbara's dresses on. And he put a red coat with a fake fur collar on over that. He was still wearing very beat-up old slacks, and he had shoes that were cut open and flopping. And his feet were filthy. We brought him into the vestibule, and once he got into where it was warm, he started to shake uncontrollably. At first, I thought he was going to have a seizure. And then, I invited him into the apartment. And he came in, and I said, "Maybe you'd like to take a shower." And then he started to cry. We had a lot of records out because we were planning a Christmas party in the next week, and we were trying to decide which ones to play. And it turned out that he knew all about American rock and roll. And he said, "Oh, look, you have Clyde McFadden, Ivory Joe Hunter, Winoni Harris, Lee Dorsey. You really seem to know all the people and all the songs." We had some leftover Chinese food, and we heated it up and gave it to him. And he gobbled down two giant helpings. And then, suddenly, he got sick, went to the bathroom, and threw up. Then he showered. And when he came out, he looked worse, because we could really see his face now, and he seemed ravaged, as if he was dying of a wasting disease. He had put his own clothes back on, and Barbara's, because I guess he was afraid that if he didn't wear them, we wouldn't let him keep them. So he was wearing her dress and her tights, and his own beat-up slacks and flannel shirt. His clothes smelled awful. He wanted to listen to an old Ivory Joe Hunter early rock and roll album, and I put it on, and he sat down to listen to it and fell asleep. He snored very loudly, and then he curled up into a fetal position. I didn't know what to do, so I told Barbara to go to bed, and I would stay out here and keep my eye on him. And of course, I fell asleep too. And when I woke up in the middle of the night, he was still there, in the chair. And he had his thumb in his mouth. I fell asleep again. And when I woke up in the morning, when it was light out, the rock and roll records were gone. And he was gone. But Barbara's tights, her dress, and her coat were lying there. And I never saw him again. But his smell lingered in that apartment for weeks. That fetid, unclean odor. We threw out the towels he dried himself with after his shower. And eventually, we threw out the chair he'd slept on. A big, leather-upholstered armchair. A family heirloom Barbara had gotten from her grandfather. What he did with the records, I have no idea. All I remember is how relieved I was that he was gone. You see the homeless everywhere in Santa Monica, standing beside grocery stores, supermarkets, restaurants, gas stations, ATM machines, sitting against buildings, rolled in blankets on benches, pushing supermarket carts filled with cans and all their worldly possessions, standing on highway dividers. You're parked at a red light beside a ravaged-looking man with a cardboard sign that says, homeless, hungry, willing to work for food. And you're confronted by a decision. What am I going to do about this? You wonder if the man standing beside your car is responsible for the squalid condition in which he finds himself. Was it alcohol? Drugs? A stupid, irresponsibly led life? Or is he a victim? Or are both true? If you decide not to help him, you avert your eyes and stare at the street ahead of you, or at a distant billboard, or you scrutinize your dashboard and self-consciously reach for your radio dial and change the station. You don't know if he's staring at you or not. Finally, after what seems an eternity, the light changes, and you drive off, relieved. And if you lower your window, reach into your wallet, and offer him a dollar, you can't help wondering how much money he makes standing at that corner. And you begin to feel angry that he doesn't go out and get a job. After all, only a few yards down the median from him is a Mexican selling oranges. Now, if the Mexican is willing to work for a living selling oranges, by what right does this man expect to receive money from strangers for simply standing on a corner with a sign? So you feel he's trying to rip you off. However, when you give them money, most of the homeless say, in a very warm and heartfelt manner, God bless you. And it makes you feel somehow better. The heartfelt gratitude of a poor person can mean more than the blessings of a priest. You feel elevated, as if you've been touched by the deity. A few days ago, I saw a woman with three little children, all in rags, standing near the corner grocery store. As I approached them, I felt a mounting wave of anger against the mother, thinking, low, to use your own children as a device to get money. As I came closer, the woman looked up and asked if I could spare a few dollars for her and the kids. It was impossible to deny her. I reached into my pocket, gave her a few dollars, listened to her warm and kindly, "Thank you so much, God bless you," and went into the grocery store. Have you ever been approached by one of those con artists who comes rushing up to you and gives you a story? Says, "I'm sorry to bother you, but I just came in from Buffalo. I thought I had a job here, but things didn't work out. I have two young children. One of them is sick. They're in my car three blocks down. I swear this is true. I just need a couple of dollars so I can find a place to stay, get some food for the kids. I'm so embarrassed to do this. I've never done this before in my life. I had a regular job in Buffalo, but they closed the factory." And he's worked himself up so that his eyes are wide. There's a little spittle in the corner of his mouth, and he's gesturing wildly with his hands. He's almost hyperventilating. And you wonder, why did he pick me? He must have sensed that I'm weak. He must have looked at me and known he had a sucker. But what if you treat someone like that as though he's lying? What if you say, "Hey, don't bullshit me. I'm not stupid. I'm not from the farm. I was born and raised in this city, and I've seen better lines than yours, so back off. And if you don't, I'm gonna call a cop." But you can't say that, because God is watching. And even though the story he tells you is dubious, you also think, well, whatever has led him to this pass, he is clearly in trouble. There is nothing more foul than the fetid odor of the homeless. The sight of them depresses and enfeebles us. Their presence is morally and spiritually debilitating. I don't want to see these people. I don't want to smell them. I don't want to think about them. The whole experience of being near them is repulsive and nauseating. How can people let themselves go down like that? I want them gone from the streets, the alleys, the parks, the beaches. I want the clean, safe, orderly, secure, comfortable, civilized world that I once lived in again. Take them away. Take them to a far country. I cannot bear to look at their misery. Seal them up behind a wall. Compact them with the rest of the trash. Deposit them on uninhabited islands. Force them all out of sight into subterranean caves, or use them as fertilizer for fields. Just get them away from here. I'm sickened by the sight of them.
I had around about 250 on me. I'm going to the bootleggers to go get my crew something to drink, because I know everybody's gonna wake up with the shakes. Time I get across the street, you know, with a little, when you go up to the little playground, I see these two crates there. I say, damn, I say, well, they might need something to eat first before they drink. Open up one of the crates, quarts and half a gallon of all top shelf brand liquors. I took the whole crate, Napoleon brandy, cognac, Smirnoff, 100 proof. We had all top shelf stuff. And we stayed drunk for a month. We stayed drunk for a month.
I'm a dope fiend, man. I ain't no boozer. But now I will drink myself one now. As you can see. See, I had to get another drink, you know, to keep it going. See, I do a little window cleaning.
Look at some of these things here, man. Yeah, man.
I'm from Mississippi. Ask me any questions you want to, and I'll tell you. I'm a co-alcoholic.
With who?
The liquor bottle. I'm a drunk. I was born and raised in Mississippi, and I was a drunk way before I came here, and I'm still one, a drunk. I drink about over a fifth a day, more than that. Cause see, I like beer, wine, vodka, tequila. Yes, darling, you want your interview? You're welcome. Good. I drink my drinks, I pass out, I have my blackouts. I was at several alcoholic programs. I was at Carrick Hall. Yes. I stayed there for 29 days. And then I've been to the other center. What's his name?
You ever go to RCA?
RCA, yes! Basically
we good people, you know, like I told you, man, you know, I'm just myself.
We don't involve nobody, we don't take nothing from nobody.
And if you get a chance, right, and you can, look out for me for a size 38 pants and a shirt so I can change clothes. I ain't gonna take me a time to change clothes. Alright? And I know you're good hearted. Let me tell you something, man, about the good Lord, how the good Lord bless his people. We'll go around, come back around. One day, I will stand back up and look out for you. Do you remember my name?
You've been listening to Joe Frank. This program is called Raymond. It was produced in 1997 for the series In the Dark.